We play for the legacy. We play for the prestige. We play for the glory. We play for one goal.
All right then, ladies and gentlemen, carrying the IEM trophy, the mayor of Katowice, Marcin Krupa. Shiz just got real! It is time for semi-finals day. Katowice, are you ready for this? I knew it! Semi-finals day. This, one of the biggest esports events in the world. So big, it's now over two weekends. And you know what? It's all about that trophy. The lion's share of $250,000. And yesterday was good. Today is gonna be even better because we have four teams battling out for that spot in the grand final in this, the Spodek here in Katowice. So let's just check to see what fans we have in. Do we have any Astralis fans? Okay. Do we have any Heroic fans? Do we have any Immortal fans? Do we have any FaZe fans? Yes, so then, let's get it on. The first quarterfinal here in the Spodek. A place in the semi-finals is up for grabs. Katowice, are you ready? I don't think you're ready. Katowice, are you ready? Damn right you're ready. Let's get it on. The first quarterfinal here in the Spodek. Please welcome FaZe and Immortals.
Different nationalities. They went unfazed in their group and now in the semi-final. And Immortals, death-defying Kappa Wearer, performed and they managed to get themselves once again a surprise spot in the semis. Can they continue to surprise is the question. Yanko, we've got some real big Counter-Strike names standing there on the stage.
Of course, we have some long tenured players like Kerrigan, who was, you know, in the world's best team when it came to the end of the 1.6 era. Al was actually a rising star back then, right? He just was breaking out in the scene as someone who's a great talent with the Finnish team. So then you have in CSGO new stars, the likes of Nico, the likes of Rain as well, guys who weren't really known internationally in previous versions of Counter-Strike. So it's really exciting to see all these different players come together, and especially considering they're all from different countries.
It was such an intriguing discussion when this project was first adopted, Chad, whether this could work, whether you could really just go and have players from different countries communicating in a second language, just picking all the all-star names and making it work. And it has been a long road to get to a point where they stand on a semi-final stage.
Yeah, late last year before Carrigan joined, I was saying this was a failed project during the Pro League.
That's right.
And, you know, this isn't going to work. They need some leadership. They don't have that. As soon as Carrigan joins the ranks, it's a complete turnaround. This team has looked like they're super structured. They have an idea of what they're doing. They're able to utilize their players and stars in roles that make sense. We're not just seeing everybody going over the map and looking for a pick. So what Carrigan's been able to do to this unit, and now with the addition of Nico, potentially the final piece of this puzzle, you know, we never know where they're going to go in this tournament. It's going to be absolutely insane to see if they're able to carry that group stage form across to the semifinals.
Match made in heaven, would you say, Yanko, seeing Carrigan join the ranks? Is he the catalyst in this success?
I definitely was very excited first when Carrigan joined, because it's been, people need to understand this, it's been a year and FaZe didn't make a playoff of a LAN tournament. Like, yeah. That has to happen at least by a fluke, you know, you play so many tournaments. Still didn't happen for them, even though they had immense individual talent in the lineup. So it just shows you how much leadership is actually important for a team. And I'm particularly excited when Nico joined the team, because he actually now plays under a proper in-game leader. And he's a great guy to have as a secondary caller, someone who's gonna, you know, give you info, make it easier for you. In Mouse, I think he had to do too much being the in-game leader of the team. I don't think he was suitable for that role.
And of course, on your screens now, we have the Immortals finishing above. I say finishing, they're not done with their run yet, but they have already managed to go ahead and surpass their master. SK couldn't quite make it to this stage, and now Immortals have an opportunity to get to that grand final. It's been a turbulent time for the likes of Bolt, Steel, removed from that Brazilian roster, and now they're managing to do quite magical things on their own.
Yeah, I think all of these players over the course of CSGO have played with Fallen at some point.
Right.
So they've all learned from him, they've all learned that mentality. And, you know, Fallen is the father of Brazilian CSGO, at least in the more modern era. And these guys have that passion, that heart that we know for Brazilian Counter-Strike. And now that FNX is in that team, we were touching on it yesterday, he was more like a general. You know, he's not the in-game leader, but he looks like he was dictating, he was pumping the guys up. He was telling them what they needed to do in pressure situations and keeping them calm. And having somebody who's so experienced like FNX on your side is such a huge, you know, positive for this squad.
Absolutely. Now we do need to jump into the map discussion. FaZe versus Immortals. What's springing to mind when we start talking vetoes, Chad?
I think the bans are pretty obvious, right? I think we're going to see Cobble definitely gone from FaZe, and Immortals just to get rid of Nuke like they have been the entire tournament.
Right.
The picks is where it gets interesting for me, because if I was Immortals, I'd be looking to throwing in like an Inferno. We saw them play that map earlier in the tournament, and they had a really decent default. They're able to move Henny around on that CT side with the AWP and pick players off left, right, and center. So that's a plus for them. And we haven't seen FaZe with Nico play this map. Or I don't think FaZe has played this map at all yet competitively. So.
Yeah, the issue here for FaZe is that they beat Immortals in the group stage, right? They beat them on overpass, they beat them in that tiebreaker on train. So the question is, what do they go for in terms of picks? You were right in Immortals going for Inferno, so FaZe does switch things up. They don't go for an overpass pick, they go for Mirage. It's always a tricky subject. Do you pick the map that you already beaten a team on in the same tournament? Because right. Once you beat a team, you don't really look back at that game. Yeah, we just won, everything's going great. Well, the losing team is obviously going to look back at it, figure out the mistakes, you know, come up with new ways to play against you, beat you on the map. So I think it's a good thing for FaZe to switch things up. But with Immortals pick on Inferno, you didn't see FaZe play it, but it's still a new map,
yeah.
Right? So it is tricky playing it, because it's still a bit random in my eyes.
To see train as the third map makes sense, right? We saw them play that in the tiebreaker of the tournament, and you know, both teams actually went back and forth. What did we go to, 3 or 4 overtimes in that?
It was a 10-7 score.
Yeah. So it was relatively close, right? They're able to push each other, especially on gun rounds. We have to see how it actually plays out. But FaZe had a lot of success on train through that group stage.
They did indeed, yes. Victories versus Astralis, excuse me, Optic, NIP, and playing Astralis on train. They definitely seem to have it in their playbook as one they like to fall back to, and it's the decider. But the Inferno is the first map, and so I want to make sure we have a chance to talk about it. A new map, new introduced into map pool. You can't have played a lot competitively. So surely this is a bit of an all or nothing play. You're on a semi-final stage, you are an underdog, you go for an Inferno pick.
Yeah, it is interesting, especially considering FaZe had 2 days to just practice. Right? I'm sure they would have thought about Inferno, because, you know, even when it was North or Immortals, both of those teams were willing to throw Inferno in. So they have definitely prepared, at least a little bit. When it comes to the map itself, you can see teams are still figuring things out. A lot of people are using that boost towards B, towards CT spawn. I don't think that's viable anymore, because everyone's just pre-firing it now, even if there's a smoke there. Banana control, we've seen different approaches. Teams on the CT side letting the T's get banana control early, but then fighting for it late. So I'm going to be interested to see how FaZe approaches it.
Okay, interesting to see how FaZe approach it. We are actually raring to go, Chad. I just want to know who you think is going to pick up the Inferno win.
I got to go with the Mortals here. I got faith in them after what I saw yesterday. I want them to start strong and pick up where they left off. And I think this map, you know, being a bit of a random choice by them might have thrown FaZe off. And hopefully they start strong.
And the fight, same for you, question to you, Yanko.
B is going to be a lockdown because Nico plays B, so that's a no-go and easy for your face.
There you go. Apparently, it's a split desk. Apparently, Nico's going to have a big stop sign down banana. Or will Immortals pick up their first map win of the semi-final? Will they start with the wildcard Inferno and burn FaZe's hopes just a little bit quicker? Right, we're going to take a break. When we come back, our first semi-final begins. And if you want updates on how everything does go down here and yesterday and the day before, the score, Esports application is available on your smartphone device. News, articles, statistics, everything under one roof. Go check it out. When we come back, it will be FaZe Immortals on Inferno.
Already, but they are gaining fans here in the Spodek. You already heard it earlier. These two teams got the loudest response. So FaZe and Immortals about to throw down on Inferno.
Yeah, and I mean, Rain's got his samurai bun going.
He looks like
today.
It, yeah. So he's playing some For Honor, it looks
he's
like.
He's ready. It is going to be a big deal, obviously. Yeah. With the Immortals, it's got to be someone like Henny. We saw FNX have incredible impact with the kind of experience he brings over from SK, obviously, the new addition. And I think that's the big thing we're going to follow, is FNX and Immortals. Yeah. And also, Nico and FaZe is the other huge one. Yanko telling us how good he is at working a banana out there on the analyst desk.
The other thing with FaZe is they only had, 3 days roughly practice with Nico prior to this, and it was rough. They were struggling a bit, but we are live into this now. It all comes down to what they can do on the day, and this is the day to prove it all. T-side will be Immortals, and already we'll see if that B-hold, that banana play that we know that Yanko loves so much from Nico, is going to be up to scratch.
Here's a delayed peek down. He spots one. Now, he does have two teammates in the bomb site behind him. So, I mean, this is a situation where if he does fall being this aggressive, they've got people to cover it up quickly. And actually, one's rotating off just as I say that. Alu heading back towards the A bomb site. Might be a rough time of it because Bolt shuts him down. So the stop sign in Banana is not quite erected just yet.
The one thing is, though, I guess you kind of encourage people to then hit the B site, right? You get that one pick, like, Aria, let's maybe consider B quickly, but they already have a player there, but no matter what, Alu could have rotated over anyway. It doesn't massively change too much, as we do see another player kind of pushing themselves over. That'd be Rain. Kyo's probably maybe going to sit in CT Arch, but so far it's a good read if they actually commit to this.
Yeah, a good read and a gutsy read to devote this much attention over towards the B bomb site before the indication of the hit is coming. So, I mean, they've got a pretty decent defense set up for this.
Yeah, Alu's got to be the one to pinpoint this one down. No, FNX is going to do it. And so far, Immortals incredibly clean, making the site hit. But Kerrigan still alive, and Rain is on the way in. But FNX and Lucas dominate B, and it is theirs. Bomb's going to go down any second now. Kyo, you have not got a hope in hell. FNX looks like he's turned up to play.
Yeah, that was a blistering start. I mean, all of Immortals hitting their shots. That was really, really sick. And I mean, it's a little bit unfortunate. FaZe had some of the fights they wanted there. They just lost all of them. So very, very nice job from Immortals. Just easy once they get that pick on Nico. Just march their way up Banana. And a simple execute. Not not too much in the way of nades for FaZe in this round, but I mean, obviously very dangerous. Two deagles, the 5-7, which is, I mean, somehow doesn't get a lot of attention, has extremely powerful pistol with all the other ones that we have.
Yeah, and we'll see what they can do with them. FaZe, they've got people like Niko. You put them on a deagle, you give them armor, there's more than just a threat on the board. If anyone dares peek up on that. We saw a couple of boosts as well coming out from Immortals. They like to do that against, it was Optic earlier on. They played that a lot, so could be punished if they go for it again.
Remember as well, we saw Virtus Pro play this map, how aggressive they were in Banana.
I love seeing Nepenex trying to crouch them when you can still just run through that part, just out of like sheer habit alone.
Yep, it is a little bit awkward. New map. But yeah, we saw how aggressive Virtus Pro was, and Niko at least is pressuring as a CT towards Banana early on in these opening two rounds of the match. But this is just a very nice default setup from Immortals. Lucas is taking control of A halls. He's got Steel there to help support. Watching for any kind of aggression, any kind of those peaks. About just under a minute left in the round and still no progress, no indication of where they're gonna end up. Two players probing into the B bomb site. They're getting brought into Niko's deagle, and that's exactly Kerrigan's plan. Just a little bit of a presence and fall back for Niko. So everyone from Immortals says no more B bomb site this round.
Massive lean towards A. Coming in now from the T side, and everyone's over by CT Archie for FaZe. They've got three players basically around the pit and balcony, so it depends where Immortals take this. There could be trouble, but no rain. Not going to give it up just yet. Going to back away and find a new angle and let them wrap towards site. 25 seconds, so things get a little bit dangerous at this point. If things go wrong like that, if things go wrong, it can go really wrong. There's a player waiting on the site, but no, they check for it. But Niko and the Deagle still rings true. Lucas is low, 7 HP, and Alu's found another. This is still dangerous. It's a 3v2, and there's 10 seconds left.
Yeah, and the flank is coming up for mid. Kerrigan's gonna stop this, and that should be the round. FaZe just needs to hide. They've done it, though. He's gonna get the plant down, but he has to stick it, and there it is. Now the round is over. Niko coming up huge, three big kills. And Immortals get stopped cold.
That has got to hurt if you're Immortals. You thought maybe you had that, but when you leave it that late in the round and there's still that many players up, you know there's going to be a threat.
And I mean, it's a huge detail that it ends up being is that missed Molotov in the pit to flush that player out. How much time did Kiyoshima buy with still being alive? That denies access to the bomb site. It makes it so difficult to get in, especially when the bomb planner has low HP. So just one missed nade, and that's the margin of error.
Immortals trying to find any sort of ground. Nice control. They've got at least apps. That's something at this point. And Kyo's the one going to be waiting on the other side. He's down in pit, playing off that new kind of area. He can push himself up.
A little bit of a dangerous smoke, though. I mean, that's
actually... It allows him to jump out.
Yeah, it does. That's pretty deep under the balcony. Nice nade, though. Chip damage. Still two players for Immortals pressuring over towards B. This is kind of set up as the default we just saw in their gun round. So. I mean, still with these pistols can be dangerous, but they don't have any smokes. So they've got to rely on these deagles. They've got to hope they find a pick, and there's an opportunity. Rain's giving Lucas a chance, but the shots don't connect.
No, and FaZe aren't giving them much, to be fair. FaZe is sitting back pretty calm in this. You know, even Rain then, you know, he got a little close. Kyo's got to be careful. Steel can still do something, but he got tagged up earlier, so the mere 58 HP going to be tough to work with if he does want to play out of this one, and no one from FaZe is moving here. They are being very calm and collected, playing incredibly deep. Smokes and mollies, just buying time. We're down to 40 seconds now.
This is very disciplined from FaZe. I mean, Steel's been here for a long time, just looking to see someone expose himself just to try and get a little bit of a lucky shot, and it's not happening. But they're going to be tested once again at this bomb site. Rain playing very much the same position.
And here we go, it's go time. FNX is already pushed up. Alu's maybe going to be in trouble here. There's a bit of a problem, and now the hit comes in, but Alu takes the timing, and he takes it well. Two big kills for him, and they stop the push before it starts. Good positioning from Kyo as well. Will just manage to stay alive. And it's just down to FNX. Now, he does have armor, he does have a gun. And the bomb's not that far away, but with a mere 13 seconds, it's not looking likely.
Yeah, but I mean, any kill he gets here is just bonus. I mean, that's forcing rebuys, and there's one. That's Kerrigan down. And this all of a sudden gets a little bit dicey in terms of the money, but he can't grab that one, and Niko's gonna be able to salvage the M4. So they do take damage, but they sustain no plant for Immortals, so FaZe should be in a position where they can farm up a little bit, make some money here, probably not taking too much damage to some of these easy pistols that'll come out.
And FNX quietly has been doing really well for his team throughout this tournament. His damage average throughout this entire event so far has been pretty much, I think, within the top five, if not top three. So he has been doing nicely for himself coming into this roster. And he's just going to have to kind of deal with the fact, though, he's going to be on a lot, well, in a lot of trouble, should I say. Is Kerrigan going to clean up? Three kills. It's a bit of an eco bash, but it's going to pad the scoreline. And it's a lot of money falling into FaZe's pocket now. And Alu, oh god, that flash is rough. But the USP will do the job just fine. FaZe keep four alive and they farm it up.
Yeah, nice. I mean, Kerrigan getting three kills with the UMP, so a lot of bonus money going his way to help recover from that second round. There it is, right off the bat. Alu with the AWP. Two UMPs going to begin on Kiyoshima and Kerrigan. They're going to be brought into this. Not a huge deal, especially Kerrigan. He seems to be playing a little bit more supportive for Nico over in that B bomb site.
And I actually really like this. This is something you saw from Astralis as well. As soon as they get the AWP up, especially if it goes towards A, for example, when Device does it, they'll send three straight over towards B, deep nades go down, maybe face a little towards Banana, and you just get a little bit more control of the map. They'll back someone over, like Kyo's just come back now, but Alu, are you kidding me right now? It's AWP! What a shot on Lucas! You do not expect that one to be coming down mid.
Yeah, but you like to see that kind of confidence out of your AWP right in the fourth round, setting the tone. That's going to be a big deal later on. Immortals, I've got to be a little bit worried. Double Molotovs down Banana. They're trapping him in the nade stack as well. FaZe has come prepared for Inferno.
I really like the late hit on Banana as well. That wasn't that instant like double nade down or deep mollies. That was later in the round. That was like 30, almost 40 seconds in.
Well, the double Molotov, one is close and one is far. So if anyone's caught in the close-up Molotov, they have to fall back into the deep one. And the only pocket of safety is that cubby where the tree used to be. So the double nade there does the damage. Very, very smart from FaZe.
Now, Kerrigan's on the boost as well, so this is pretty problematic here. Even if it's just the UMP, you can get work done if that smoke goes in, which they do have on steel. So let's see if he can make the most of it, or maybe Immortals are aware. We saw a couple of players getting completely decked off this position by these guys as well, and a nice turn. And actually, Nico falling as well means trouble. They've now got the B side to themselves. Bomb's going to go down, smoke towards CT, and they go in dry on this.
Yeah, that can't happen, especially Henny pushing up to find Alu. This is a 3-on-5 that Immortals has a huge advantage in now. Rain's got to make something happen. They have one kit on Kiyoshima. He's coming a little bit late. They've only got a couple flashbangs to work with on the retake, and the smoke still up is going to make things difficult. And Rain's going to have to lead the way.
No one's actively facing this. FNX is now. He's come around from dark, but then Kyo watches the angle. Kyo's the one doing the heavy lifting here, and Rain just needs to land one more shot. Kyo, one bullet will do everything, and that's fine. He's got the kit, and I'm pretty sure he's got the time.
That's very nicely done. Kiyoshima, two big kills. That's a retake that seems so sketchy, but I mean, heartbreaking loss for Immortals in that round if they pull it back, but you have to say they did great damage. They get a plant, so still the economy of the CT side. You can see these Molotovs. What do you do here? There's nowhere for you to go if you're bolts. That's the danger of that kind of a setup. So smart from FaZe, but still it gets sketchy in the end. Immortals, though, they get benefited. We've seen a couple times on Cobble where they've had some success just kind of, you know, walking up, and teams weren't really looking for information. And again, at the B bomb site, one player boosted and one player at coffins, not really peeking to see if that kind of dry walk up is going to happen. So this is now a tendency where Immortals are willing to attack bomb sites late in the round if they're at a disadvantage with no utility.
Alu is having a really, what a confident start. That's what you want to be feeling in this one, getting a good read of how Immortals are playing it out. And he is just tearing up them apart down second mid at this point. Now, Steel again, over towards Apps. Kyo's the one who'd receive on the other side if he does come leaping out, but Henny and Bolt still trying to deal with that Banana presence. Nico this time far more active in towards it, and so is Kerrigan. Now they can back off. Now they've got a bit of time, and they've reset the playing field.
Yeah, Immortals still very spread out. Lucas and Steel over in these A halls. Henny and Bolt's working their way up mid and alt mid on through underpass, so it looks like it's going to be a heavy hit towards halls. No real presence in mid unless they come out of boiler. So this is going to be interesting. It looks like Kiyoshima is going to be tested once again, and that could be dangerous because Kiyoshima has been coming up big for FaZe, not only in this map so far early on, but just in this tournament, these past couple tournaments for FaZe. Kiyoshima has been very, very good individually. And this Molotov is heartbreaking.
They do have smokes, but is this where you want to be using it? I think this is a tough one. And the nade.
What a jerk.
Insult to injury, Kyo. All right, he's backing away from this. I think they're going to feel, especially now. Here we go. Let's see if Kyo is going to be a problem or not. He does go down quickly. Bolts again. He finds a pull-up. Rain unable to achieve much in that situation, but it's Alu keeping it in check. 15 seconds remain, and Steel needs to get that bomb down, but default, it's not safe. But now it is. Steel hits a blinder on towards Kerrigan, who into the 2v2. Alu trying to play it smart, trying to get the timing right with Nico. Let's see if that team play is already there. And there it is, Nico with a nice bit of timing towards Henny, and now Steel, 9 HP. And not much else beside him, but he gets one. It's all possible still. And he's got to know where Nico is, but it is the danger man himself. Nico doesn't often lose these situations, and Steel, you better be ready. Nico again keeps control, keeps calm, and comes up with the goods on stage.
Really, really nice one-on-one from Nico. You can see the way he's attacking that bomb site. You can see Steel's at that headshot angle, so it's a little bit of a tough battle for Nico to take. So Nico crouching actually forces Steel to commit to a fight wide. He makes sure that Steel can't see him over the top of that box, so that's what helps him win that round. That's what kind of gives him the advantage back in that fight. Nice pick from Alu, though, as well. Prevents any players from Immortals really establishing pit control for the post plant. And now 5-1. Immortals winning the pistol round and getting blanked ever since.
Yeah, it's pretty rough for them, isn't it?
Yeah, you're not going to be happy with that one.
No, so tactical timeout. These are best of threes, though. These guys get to kind of, not coast, but you get a little bit more play, right? You get more play to come into this one. And FaZe, let's bear in mind, they didn't have yesterday to play. They've just been doing prac. They've been grinding it out more than anything. These guys said it. They haven't had much time to, you know, work with Nico yet. This was their time to get ready. And we know the kind of history of people going straight to semis doesn't always work out well. So for FaZe, they want to buck that trend. And we are back underway.
I think you got to feel a little bit bad for Immortals because, I mean, the last two rounds have been plants and have come down to one-on-ones. But unfortunately, actually, FaZe's economy isn't as hurt as you might think in that kind of a situation. They still have an okay amount of money built up behind it. So, I mean, normally, if you're Immortals, you have to be feeling like because of these past two rounds, you may have them on the breaking point in terms of their economy, but it's not there. And that spam is no fun. A couple dinks to the head, but it doesn't do huge damage. But it is a lot of big annoyance, basically.
Was that from Keo as well?
Yes.
That was really far away.
This is one of the big things from what I've talked to pro players about early on in this Infernal Lifespan. One of the big gripes they have with the map is the fact that these A-halls are entirely spammable, even deep into the bomb site as we just saw. And that's something that can be very, very frustrating and very random to play against.
Hopefully for Immortals, they've come up with some sort of thought pattern as to how they want to approach this one now. Sitting at 5-1, you want to get yourself on the board to have that nice competitive half, give yourself that good buffer for CT, whether you win the pistol or not. And it looks like maybe again testing the water over by A, but we've seen them working either way on this one. Bolt's now to be left over by Banana. And he kind of falling back a little bit, but look where the bomb is. It's in FNX's hands, and it is not going towards A. But Alu finding Steel might actually sell this a little bit more. Look at Kerrigan, he's rotating away. It's down to Nico. 4 players on the other side of that smoke, and I think he's got an idea. Underhands of smoke, oh, this is brave, Nico. This could be huge. There's one, almost felt it could have been there for him, but no, FNX powers on through, but the problem is the molly's burning, and Kerrigan setting fire to this round already. Looks for the follow-up, but he can't find it. FNX waiting in the smoke.
Yeah, I mean, Nico only gets one kill there, but what he does get is a wealth of information. So when Kerrigan does rotate all the way back, he's ready with that flashbang, ready with the Molotov as well, and he's able to defend that B site. Really nice coordination. That's one of the benefits of taking that fight. It is a little bit risky taking a fight that far from the bomb site, but one of the benefits is that information gathering. And now, I mean, you can even see Alu. We've seen him peek down towards alt mid. We've seen him just peek from the CT side of mid, and now we've seen him peek into the halls from the A bomb site. So being very, very mobile over on this side of the map with the AWP, and that's got to be confusing for Immortals.
He's got a decent spawn as well. Yeah, he's going to go for that straight up peek, and he spots someone going.
Tags him.
Yeah, that's not fun. And the thing is, you don't often see Alu being, you know, the kind of versatile, flashy AWPer. It feels like a while. There's always been that big potential, right? So nice to see him finding a little something here. But Bolt, he's going to be taken down very swiftly, and FaZe not easing off at all.
Yeah, deep smoke, deep Molotov as well. Even if Bolts had teammates there to help him out, they would have been unable to. Lucas trying to get some of the Tech Nine, and he does there right at the end. Fortunate little bullet takes down Alu. That is one thing, though. Alu and this FaZe lineup has slowly but steadily increasing in his confidence and his impact in these games.
Nice boost towards Diggity. So Keo's just going to be sat up and over that. And you can go even further on towards the kind of flower beds and again around the back. So Keo's in a bit of an OP spot now. This is going to be tough for them to break into. But Rain kind of have to pick up the mantle of where he normally sits. So a new crossfire is formed.
Go on alt, though. He'll be the one taking contact if they come up mid, and that's the thing. This can be a pretty deadly crossfire, especially now since they call troops. He's going to get 2 kills. It's not even going to matter. Falling down. Keo gets a third. Nico doesn't have to do very much work at all. 7-1, and now the money is building up. These past two rounds have been so strong, and we're going to get another pause out of Immortals because they know it. 4 players on FaZe surviving the past two rounds, so all that economic damage that Immortals had been doing is now gone to waste.
I really like that spot from Keo as well. It was nice. It's a little unorthodox, a little annoying. You used to be able to kind of jump onto it from the balcony side, I guess, but really, really like that. And now we've got a double AWP as well coming out for FaZe.
And I think if I'm Immortals in this timeout, I'm maybe, you know, calling off this default that they've been setting up with 2 towards ban and some indoor talls. I mean, listen, you've been running it for 8 rounds. It hasn't gotten you much. It got you a pistol run, and that's about it. Now you need to be a little bit more aggressive, a little bit more assertive. There are places on the map that FaZe, I mean, over towards the A bomb site, it's what?
A's. There we go. Yeah. The FaZe woke up. The F finally woke up.
Yeah, well, you know, FaZe up had to come up. Jesus. It's early in the day still.
Why are you doing this?
But no, I mean, over at the A bomb site, it is like Alu on rap side, Rain and Lane. I mean, if you can isolate some of these players and find, you know, man advantages.
That is rough. But we're also going to see Henny as well on the AWP here. So let's see if this one works out. The pause is done and dusted, but there it is. Finally, Henny makes a big impact to start with, punishing Alu's aggression and finally getting a bit of an advantage into a round. It feels like a long time for this to be happening. And look at Henny, instantly worried about that boost coming through. And it's a valid worry.
Yeah, well, they might get caught off guard here. Yep, and they do, exactly. Niko switches things up as well, picks up the AWP, and he equalizes very quickly. So Immortals, I mean, still, as a T-side, you have an advantage in the 4-on-4, but definitely don't want to be giving up a free kill to bring it back into that kind of a situation. So now as well, this is interesting. Kerrigan's going to be the one staying at B. Niko's going to cheat over towards the A bomb site with that AWP. But Immortals, they're in no position to do any kind of aggression to take advantage of anything at the moment.
Yeah, Kyo again has been excelling in these sort of spots, so be aware. He's going to see the gun barrel as well. He's going to just shoot into it. Kyo will not be moved in these situations. Rain now joins in, but Niko is there instantly in support. Henny, you've done well, but doing well might not be good enough at this point. We'll see. 1v2. One man behind him. One towards the site. He's got a lot of time. He's got a smoke and a molly. There's play here.
Great awareness by Kiyoshima. He was spotted on the boost, drops down, and is very, very aware someone could be lurking out. But this is going to be tough. Henny has been so clutch. It doesn't look like anyone's really expecting us from the phase side of things. It's going to be down to timing, and it's not with Kiyoshima. Henny finds himself into a one-on-one with Kerrigan coming up mid. This would be a huge round for Immortals to win.
Kerrigan is not making a sound. Henny, you've got to know where Kerrigan was playing, but will you expect him to be working this quickly? They don't see each other. Kerrigan now, molly to hand, Kit as well. Has it all, but Henny has the angle. This is the problem, and Henny strikes, but he gets the tag. It's not enough. Kerrigan now mollies him out. This is dangerous. Oh my God, it's not on it. It's spreading though, and it goes down. It spreads far enough. Henny just about does it for Immortals for the second one on the board. Four kills that round for him. And Kerrigan, you've got to be frustrated.
Yeah, there's a world you could almost feel that defuse coming in. The Molotov spreads. Nice play from Henny. I mean, big time play, but they lose four players, so this buy up again. I mean, stuck on a couple of Galils, but I mean, Henny with this AWP, again, a chance to have a huge impact. One on two clutch, but also three kills overall in the round.
This time, Niko, no warp there, so not going to be taking a wander down Banana, just going to be sitting up at the top. Steel. Again, these guys like going to this, but I like the deep smoke coming out on Banana. You can see them starting to try and show dominance down here. Niko and Kerrigan both doing it, having to keep Henny humble this time. He can't just brazenly peek out. He's not going to get gifted the kill onto Dalu, but oh my word, these guys, they're not easing off at all.
No, and another different setup. Last round it was an AWP. They've had some aggression up towards Carr. They've had the Molotov, the nade stack. So a bunch of different looks over at this B site. Niko can look over, he spots it, there's one kill, and he's just gonna fall away. Is he gonna get there? He's getting spammed through the smoke. The danger now is if they get lurked in towards Kerrigan.
Yeah, Kerrigan's low, but if they don't check it, if they don't keep that in mind, there's a possibility if they get too focused onto Niko, there could be issues, but we'll see. Again, there's so much time bought just trying to fight for any control, any step towards Banana. You need something on this, but FaZe are unrelenting, and as is Kerrigan, and as is Niko. Niko is there to support, backs away well, does not overstay his welcome, but he's low on HP, and he might need some support very soon.
Yeah, Rain's on his horse right now, but he's got to get there quickly. There is a smoke, there is a Molotov, and Niko, he's committed, going to try and catch him off guard with this off angle, and he does. Steel is a spot of man, another kill, four for him. Beautiful round, great teamwork, him and Kerrigan in Banana. One kill over the smoke, the delayed pop flash to punish two, and retreating into the site. Niko, that is dominant. There's the stop sign that Yanko was talking about.
And there's always going to be a small question mark. Well, there was a small question mark about what happens to Niko when he gets on a big stage. Because we only see it very few times in Mouse Sports. It wasn't obviously
it was
all
not
that,
very frequently.
I think it was like maybe once. I think Sao Paulo, they got to the stage. I think
E-League, they made it to the playoffs as well.
Yeah, E-League as well. This is a massive moment for these guys from Kerrigan. You know, this guy just wants to make it worse. He wants to hurt their feelings at this point, and oh, he's gonna farm some good cash playing Rain. This round is over. It should be. Oh God, don't do it now. Don't Alu, are you gonna do this as well? All right, let's see. Oh God, this is falling apart. Are you serious? Are you?
The twins.
How do you do this?
I mean, that's...
FaZe got so complacent in that round.
That's just way, way overextension, overconfidence. I mean, you can see the idea, right? When they win that round and you push down mid like that, that's demoralizing to opponents. If you win that round and just crush it, that's what really tilts them, and that's what really gives FaZe a big lead. But now, instead,
the
risk is just you've given Immortals an avenue to get back into this game, so that could have been a huge mistake.
Wow. Oh, that is just peachy. Niko, Kerrigan, Keo over by B, and maybe a new lease of life for Immortals now. They've been given a small shot to get a couple of rounds on the board, but Rain doesn't like any of that. Steel showing presence, maybe going to imply the default's coming through, but that might not be the case. There's a lot of presence towards Banana, but there's three players waiting on the other side, and Niko with the UMP still just as dangerous, but up close. Not all that personal just yet.
Look at the damage that Immortals has taken in this round. Steel down to very low, 9 HP. Lucas and Bolts, you know, right around 50, so... Great early damage with utility from FaZe. That's going to help them out, especially in a situation where they have a couple UMPs. But I mean, this is another dangerous defensive setup. They have a very, very good read on what's coming. A bit of a gamble stack. And Immortals, they have no map control towards the A bomb site. They're all at Banana. Henny looking up mid with that AWP. Niko's brought down very, very low. But remember, even if Niko and Kerrigan fall here, they've got Kiyoshima to back them up.
Now, last time Immortals played these rounds this late, it went incredibly wrong. That was a long time ago now, but things can fall apart, and this might just be, I think Niko's possibly going to go up on the first boxes, maybe just see what he can do. No, he's just going to be playing the corner. And yeah, Keo is the big problem here. If they don't check for it, if they get to Niko, just around the corner, there are a lot of bodies waiting for you. Bolts will take him down comfortably. And now Kerrigan falls back to Nubox, but this is Keo's moment, and he gets it! That's two big kills. Kerrigan burns alive in the meantime, but it's a 3v3. And can Keo do any more? Alu supported him, FNX falls, and Keo desperate for another pick.
Yeah, this is gonna be tough. Alu's not here with the AWP, no armor though, no kits as well. Bolt's getting aggressive with the AK, Keo can't win it, but Alu with the trade with that AWP, and Henny's gotta find the angle, he takes the shot. Oh, the recovery with the deagle. How has he done that? And it's AWP on AWP, but Alu's at a disadvantage. He has no kit, the Molotov. And he's trying to force Henny to go for a peek, but it's not happening. Henny in these situations has been phenomenal. I think he's done it again, just waiting patiently. And Alu's been outplayed here. Even if he gets this kill, which he does, he doesn't have time at all, though. Henny's still going to win it.
Keo almost turned that one around. Alu so close as well. But Henny has been a huge redeeming factor for Immortals in the last couple of rounds. We've seen so many moments, that Molly that just denied Kerrigan. And now you can see a Punisher. This is getting Immortals back into the game. I could have seen this scoreline being a lot cleaner if they'd actually closed out that round earlier, but that shot's just filthy.
Well, now you look at that round where they push down mid, and you know, losing that, this is essentially like a three-round swing. It looks like it's about to be three rounds over to Immortals just off that. They win that round, they win the following, and now they have a much easier time. A shotgun, some pistols, one AWP is basically what they have to worry about. But I mean, this is exactly what's gotten them back in, so the risk of that play is coming back to haunt FaZe at the moment.
Alu, finding Hen, and he just going down, they're going to be a bit of a problem. He's been a massive deciding factor for these guys, but still, the weaponry beside FaZe is so limited, but... I don't know. I've stopped guessing that FaZe are going to close out the rounds they should, because that was just ridiculous before, but there is a four-man stack towards A at the moment, so if Immortals do make their play towards us, they've got a lot of bodies to run through.
Yeah, and this time they're picking up the pace a little bit. They're not running the clock down. Steel takes some damage, but finds that kill. Kerrigan's got to do some work. He's got Kiyoshima with them, lurking them, pulling them in, and there's the shotgun. It's coming out. It's not getting the kill, finally. Now he's hiding in the smoke. Kerrigan's up next, the crossfire, but Kiyoshima's had to fall back. And actually, Immortals are stuck in the choke point. They can make no progress.
And it's buying time for Alu to come around. Keo finding bolts. This is a disaster. It's falling apart. And FaZe at the helm of destruction of Immortals. That round, again, it's crazy these rounds we're seeing.
One player in halls for Immortals, and they have someone to be able to pressure Kiyoshima from that angle. The fact that he's able to live up there with no real pressure being applied to his flank, that's what stops them in that choke point. The crossfire that setup is so strong. So FaZe hold on in a very difficult round. And now on 14, I mean, there's only pistols out for Immortals. They did win the last time, but that was from a rush from FaZe.
Please don't run down mid. Oh, all right. Please don't get punished this time. All right, nice one. There we go. Alu does what he went to do before. Maybe going to back away this time as well and just not let him get a chance. You want to get a nice, strong finish that first half. Prove yourself on the stage. Get that confidence. Get that kind of wind in your sails. So However, on the other side, let's look over at B as well. We've got a very passive side of things. Steel, though, looking to try and encroach towards mid, but not going to find anything. Alu backed away, playing a lot safer this time.
I mean, that's the thing. Man advantage, don't overextend from here. You have a 5-on-4, you have the advantage in weaponry and utility. Don't give any of those advantages up, and this is a really, really tough off angle for Immortals to be prepared for. Smoke going to come out. And it's almost like the smoke is just an indication for Immortals to go right through it. Oh, what? Henny, that's incredible.
And now Kerrigan is in trouble. 55 HP, three players. He's going to find one, but any more is going to be a tough task, and he cannot step up to the challenge. It's the 3v3 retake coming in, but a quick push down towards the ruins doesn't go so well for Bolts, but FNX will come up with the goods. He desperately wants that open. He's going to get it. Now Keo somehow stays alive, but the second one, rain falls. FNX can't do it. And now Keo up against Steel. No kit in hand either for Keo, so this could be a problem. Steel, be calm, be cool, get the round, there it is. And again, they lose these rounds.
I cannot believe Henny hits that shot around the smoke. I thought that was going to be an off angle that they were not prepared for, but he knew exactly what was going on. Nico just gets slapped aside. That is so nice, and the impact that Henny is having is incredible. The AWP has pulled him out some of their first gun rounds. Now the Deagle here for an entry. It's very, very good stuff from a guy who's no stranger to this stage.
No, certainly not. The Eagles seem to be winning rounds these days, so you know what? We'll not doubt FaZe yet. there are Tech Nines, there's UMPs, and you want a 10-5 half if you're FaZe. That means you're looking comfortable. You've got something to bring up towards that T side.
Yeah, but they have no one but themselves to blame looking back that this is not even like 12-3. I mean, that rush down mid has really, really hurt them, and then the plays from here from Immortals have been stellar. But one mistake has given the Immortals an avenue back into this match.
Yeah, and already you can see Rain Keo having to kind of respect the fact that they have so much more to play with, and Steel going to start punishing, but Alu going to be played in off the back of this, but Steel holds his nerve. Keo staying alive behind that box, can't really spam through it too well, but Lucas finds a way in, it doesn't matter, the Tech Nine ripping heads off on the site, and Immortals might just stabilize on this half after an incredibly disastrous round earlier on for FaZe.
Yeah, that's unfortunate if you're FaZe. They're going to have to reset at this halftime. Really nice recovery from Immortals, making sure they punish the mistakes of their opponent. So they're going to have six rounds going into the CT side.
FaZe managed to get 9 rounds on the board, but the big story is Immortals finding 6. Something that maybe FaZe shouldn't have allowed to happen, but it did, and now FaZe have to deal with the consequences. Immortals have a huge chance back into this, and this pistol round is the perfect start.
It's not just the scoreboard necessarily. I mean, it's the mentality. You're suffocating Immortals in that first half, and now you've given them that renewed confidence. And I mean, on top of that, you add in some of the plays that Henny has made with the Deagle, with the AWP. This is a team that's now right back into it in a lot of different ways. And FaZe, actually, look at this. Fast pace towards the B bomb. So are they actually going to hit this? That becomes the question. Yeah, here's the smoke over. Henny with the nade in his hand. He's blind. It comes out. How much damage? Decent. It's not bad. They've got FNX in the back. This is a 3-player stack for Immortals. And FaZe might just get shut down. They haven't found an avenue in. There's Alu finally. Oh, and he gets 2. Kerrigan as well. Finally, they open it up. But the retake is here very early.
Lucas is en route as well. Alu can find nowhere safe towards Banana. Steel locking them in towards the site, but Lucas can't do the job towards that player, just sliding out towards CT, and now Steel's in trouble. He knows that Alu could be pressuring him. Takes the fight, can't hit the shot though. Alu just outdoing him here, but this is awkward as hell. Steel finally wins it, and it's a 2v2. They still have a kit as well, bearing in mind. Keo's low, as is Kerrigan, and here we go. Keo needs to slow it down, deny the hit. Lucas comes in, Keo finds one, and it's just onto Steel, but they are so low, but he just can't find them. They bought time so well. Ring of Rosies and Steel, this does not feel good.
Oh, this is so uncomfortable for Steel. And Kiyoshima just knows he's won. He's out of bullets, but he still wins the round. FaZe, if you're not hitting your shots, the answer is just to play smart and don't get killed. And they do exactly that. It's not pretty at all. Very, very dicey pistol round.
Kiyo is putting on a show.
He's having a very, very good game. Definitely not a problem.
No, certainly not. 10-6 now. FaZe picking up the first in a very strange manner. Steel having a bit of a mare in that round. It just felt like the shots weren't going to land. It might just be a bit of an awkward moment for him, but hopefully he can just mentally reset. Just don't worry about that. Get back into the game. But a big buy-up coming out from FaZe. 3 UMPs, the 2 rifles, and, well, it's the nades to do the early work. And he going down. Bit of an issue here. But there's still 2 players on B. So FNX and Lucas, the job falls to you.
And actually, it's going to be FNX close up. So this could be a little bit of a bait and switch here. I doubt they expect the second player, but FNX has got to be aggressive. He can't just sit far back. He gets one, and Nico's there to just turn the corner. I don't even know if he necessarily checked that. I think he just kind of saw the second player as he's killing the first. So that's convenient. Bomb is down, though. It is a 2-on-3, and interestingly enough, Alu is still very far away watching for a mid-push, so FaZe is going to slow this down. They have plenty of time. They've just got to be cautious. As Bolt makes his play, and he finds one. Nico gets his third, but this is costly.
Yeah, bomb not planted yet. Still a little bit of a problem, but there's only 5 bullets now left. Look to the bottom right. He knows it as well now. Looking for another pistol. Looking for anything, maybe. I think there's a UMP behind him. There he goes. So he's back into this one, but no kit. And still, Nico's not predicted this. And, oh, great shot initially towards Alu, but he just suffers through. He gets the job done. 2 alive. They do lose out on... Possibly no, they recovered the other rifle as well. That's fine. So they're back in this one. FaZe, keep the money up. And that is what I mean about Keo putting on a show. He knew what he'd done. Look at that.
I mean, that part's cool, but I think everyone's going to be a little bit depressed when they look back on that round.
Oh, yeah.
The end of it.
It's rough.
So a little bit more bought up. Important to note, Henny didn't, he bought a deal last round, but didn't invest everything. He's gonna want that off quickly. We saw how much of an impact that had. He really struggled to get that in his hands in the first half. And once he did, that's when Immortals really started putting some more rounds on the board. That's kind of solved a lot of their issues in that T half. So Henny wanted to get on that as quick as possible. The A bomb site is already lost, and Rain trying to farm up some money. It's gonna be tricky. Spots the toes of Steel. And now he should just fall back. 5 HP, there's not a whole lot of farm you can do after that, and he's just gonna get taken down.
Yeah, okay, there's a rifle falling into the other team's hands now, but it's the sustain you get with the armor they just won't have. So, gets a little bit of problematic here, but Lucas, hello, that was surgical. Keo down. You've got Nico and Kerrigan to keep this one in check.
And I think they're just going to be happy to contain here. I mean, maybe send the pistols forward, but Lucas definitely not going to risk that AK-47. Even just one more kill here is going to be huge. And there it is. And he finds it. They're actually going to go for this Nico. He's right around the smoke. And actually, he's found it out. So it got really sketchy. I didn't even expect it to get that close. And then there's Nico there just to hold everything down, the security policy that FaZe now has.
there's any question if Nico will perform on stage. I think we're getting a pretty solid answer so far. And the thing is, he hasn't had to be the one player doing it. Everyone else is playing well. Keo's had a nice performance so far, especially on that CT side. He was doing really well. So, again, good stuff from Nico, considering he's so fresh into this team. Just really assimilated himself well. FNX, you can say the same. He's having a good tournament, but not outstanding this game. But this is the buy you want to see. It's not ideal from Immortals, but it's the best they can do. FNX having to just accept the fact he's on the Mag 7. It does work pretty well here. Keo's going to find out. And that's not a way you want to start the round for FaZe. So back up. FNX buys time, buys that one-man advantage. And now FaZe looking to find a response.
Yeah, free upgrade to a rifle as well for him. So nice play from FNX. And FaZe is left wondering how they're going to equalize this back into a 4-on-4. This is a little bit tough. Blocked off by Smokes at the moment, but those will start to run low for the Immortal side of things. Nico over towards the B bomb side. He was the defender, now he's the attacker. And Immortals with a big play towards mid. Three players focusing on this. FNX bolts and steel. No aggression yet from FaZe.
No, they still got enough to make a play with. And these are the sort of wall bangs you're starting to see. So bolts can't sit comfortably behind the pillars. And that could allow players to play out from mid. So Alu maybe be able to get a peek towards Diggity. We'll see if it actually happens at the end. 45 seconds. First flash comes in. Bolts are still there. And FNX in support. That's the important factor. Crossfire denies any play towards A. But look at Nico. Hard to keep your eyes away from this man when he's on form. Henny, not going to fall for it though. Nicely done from Henny, going to hold down the angle. And this seems incredibly solid from Immortals. They know they've got a long road ahead of them. And Kerrigan, there's too much to handle, and Immortals will get one on the board.
Yeah, nothing works on the other side of the map, so it essentially just falls onto Nico, playing his own over towards Banana, and they're just saying you have to find some kind of a duel. Unfortunately, it's a very, very small angle that's very difficult to look for if you're Nico entering into the B. And Henny, with one of the fastest firing speeds on the AWP we have in the professional scene, he's going to win that more often than not. So 12-7, Immortals trying to make a bit of a comeback. FaZe buying what they can into this round. This is some of that damage that was done in the previous rounds by Immortals.
What? What was that molly?
It's just a B rush.
Yeah, and the molly goes flying off somewhere. I think it was just aborted because they heard the steps coming in. And now, Henny, what can you do? I think that's a tag coming in, but he will follow up with the frag. Lovely play as well, playing in Lucas. These two are just saying a big, fat no. Goodbye this round, FaZe. You don't get a step towards B.
Yeah, Rain got blind. It was just jumping into the wall, which is a little bit unfortunate. So Henny gets two shots to take him down. But yeah, that's tough. FaZe calling the B-Rush, trying to catch him a little bit off guard. It just doesn't work out. So it's a shooting gallery for this AWP. And this is now two rounds that Henny and Lucas have played these same positions on the same side of the bomb site. That's actually really nice. Henny now, he's going to be feeling some of the confidence that Alu had in the first half, peering down mid, and there's the shot, adjusts well. Nico trying just to shoulder peek it, but he gets taken out.
We might actually have a match on our hands here, Moses. I'm hoping this keeps up this way. Honestly, Immortals bring themselves back into this game. You can see they've been almost teased with the chance of it. Still, they'll just push down mid. That's pretty nice. Now they can isolate where the rest of the players are. They'll know it's got to be towards Apps. Bolts are well aware of this, and they're not letting this one slip. Yeah, Bolts, that's a bit dangerous, just grenade in hand, peeking out brazenly towards Apps, but he's got support. Steel's going to just run in as well. Why not? It might go wrong if you don't expect a player like Alu here, but they've got the bomb, and now Keo does at least put up a fight. Oh my word, Keo, that's a nice shot. Now Bolts and FNX, they're a little low, so this becomes... All right, guys, we need to lock this down.
Yeah, looking like Immortals is close to making the same mistake that FaZe did in the first half. I mean, I don't think they can lose this, but oh, another kill. All of a sudden, this is a one-on-two. There's 1 minute left, and he's got the bomb as well. If there's just one fortunate piece of timing for Kiyoshima, this all of a sudden is very, very doable for him. He's got no armor. That's one thing he's got to worry about. But on top of everything, this is just expensive. Both teams on these anti-ecos getting very aggressive and being punished for it.
Keo could absolutely raise the roof here.
He spent so long in these halls just looking for someone, just looking for more aggression, that I think he's kind of run out of time to make anything really happen. It's going to be very, very difficult for him to find these two players. Obviously, because he hasn't had any information in so long, he just kind of has to gamble and guess where they might be, and he doesn't have much time to do it.
Well, he knows now. FNX is low, but he's got 10 seconds to make the play, and that's not a lot of time unless the shot comes in quickly. 7 seconds. Bomb's going to go down. He's going to stick it as well. Okay, bomb now planted. All right. FNX, Lucas, what do you have in store? He knows where one is, the second's the problem. Where will he be? Keo, this could be it. He could do the ace here. No armor. He has nothing. He only picked up the rifle. And oh, Lucas saves the day for Immortals. That could have been a disaster.
What a heartbreaking way to lose that round for Kiyoshima. The work he does. Oh, and that's even a cool trick. Kiyoshima in that one-on-three threw the AWP out the window into AWP mid, so Lucas goes to look for it when Henny tells him where he dies. He's not going to find it. Heartbreaking to lose that after all that work just getting spammed through the corner. Nicely done from Lucas, but all the economic damage and almost pulling it back. That's going to put Immortals on notice, and actually that's a big play. Even that you lose at phase, that's a big morale boost for them.
If one man can do that, and it's Kyo out of everyone. You know, you look at the superstars, you look for like, oh, it's gonna be Rain or Nico, or maybe Alu as well, you know, on the AWP, but no. It's gonna be Kyo doing some work here. So, we'll see if that kind of continues into the rest of this game. But Alu looking for anyone to peek down mid, but no one really has been making much play. We haven't seen too many aggressive plays from Henny coming out just yet, at least to the, I guess, standard of what we saw from Alu, which got punished eventually, but FNX has to be careful. We know that these wallbangs do exist and they hurt, and they are just going past his head.
No real control quite yet. You can see FaZe, the idea, they want to push up, they want to kind of suffocate this A bomb site. Steel on one side, bolts on the other, smokes being lined up from the FaZe guys, counter flash from Steel as well, and FNX in the sight. So the fact that there's no pit defense could help out a lot if this is a set execute. Flash bang up, and at the moment they're just content to draw out some utility, no rotations from Immortal from the B bomb site. And this is going to be a heavy play out towards Halls, and because there's no pit player, this has a chance of success. Yeah. This is doable.
Yeah, FNX could hinder this with this molly, but the smoke goes down already. Really nicely timed. That canola no longer stop this, and there we go. Three players now in towards pit. Boltz is trying to stay alive in between the mayhem. Kerrigan, Kyo, Rain, all looking to do any sort of work here, and there you go. Trade out eventually, but FNX still alive. Can't do enough. Kerrigan finds a way back in. Now, Kerrigan has the bomb, and those deep smokes towards this side, towards that mini pit area, have allowed them to play out to get that plant and still isolate that bomb site with two players who were there initially.
Just seems like a technical win just based off the strat calls. The setup that Immortals had isn't geared up to defend against that many people coming out Halls. Nico in alt mid, he's supposed to be watching the flank, but he's not going to catch it. Alu, though, he's here holding it, and he misses a shot. So, ability for the retake, but Nico is coming around like a shark. He's waiting, biding his time, and Henny's gonna have no idea. Neither is Lucas. There's the one kill. There's the... Oh, no, it's not! Lucas turns in time, and he gets another one! Lucas has been a hero so far. The Molotov's gonna slow things down, but and they can't do it. They've run out of time. Lucas almost pulls it back, but Alu with the Molotov. FaZe stay alive in this round, and they win it 13-9.
These rounds are absolutely insane. Both teams stepping up to such a huge platform here. You got to feel a couple of these rounds have been, I wouldn't say unlucky for Immortals. FaZe have worked hard, but there's been moments where it's like, oh, a second away, a couple of moments there or here could have changed everything. But at the end of the day, it's the small things, it's the small factors that define these games. And so far, FaZe have locked them down still. Not seeing one up early towards mid. Got to be careful. There are a couple of players there. Henny doesn't want to burn alive, so will back away. He's about one of the only people who can wallbang through that wall, so needs to be careful. Alu can do the same on the other side, of course. So, at the moment, FaZe not seeming too worried just yet.
Huge round for both teams. I mean, both economies are on that kind of breaking point. Very, very close to it. So, whoever wins this, I mean, it'll be whether Immortals will have a good chance at making a comeback into it or FaZe maybe just being able to run away with it. I think if FaZe wins this, Immortals just has to buy every single round, whatever they can, and it's going to be rough. So big, big stand for the defense coming up if they can make it happen. Rain isolating, bolts off with that smoke. So Steel's feeling a little bit of pressure with his teammate having no vision, and he just falls back deeper into Rapside by Library.
I really like what Rain's doing by making it uncomfortable to sit anywhere towards Quad or anywhere around here, but we're going to see if they can actually make their way out again. This is the same piece of the work. They're the deep smokes towards kind of, I guess, arch side, so they sit just in front by mini pit around that sort of area, and then they play out and they have to clear pit. This is the difference, though. FNX is here this time. Last time he wasn't, and you can see the damage he's able to cause. Steel as well. They don't get away with it this time. FaZe, they've learned from what you've done, Immortals, and now looking to follow it up. Can't close down towards Nico, but good damage dealt.
Yeah, that time, I mean, you can see just one player in pit, how much more difficult that gets. They jump out towards lane side, they jump out towards Diggity and get out one kill, eventually overtaking it. Nico is very, very low. Alu's going to have to do some work. The big question is Henny. He is the X factor for this retake. The bomb timer slowly ticking away. Only Lucas has the kit, and they're separated. So if Lucas falls, there's no chance for Henny to recover the kit in time.
And Alu's starting to walk around in towards AWP, so it is around the world. Nico finds it. That's the kit now lost. Henny, this is looking impossible, especially with Alu behind you. Happy to pick that one up and the pause has been called.
Yeah, advantage, strong advantage to FaZe now with that win. Immortals is going to be on a very, very... Actually, they're going to have an okay buy. Steel has plenty of money. Lucas can get a good gun, but the other three should be stuck on something like pistol upgraded pistols. Mm. But we've seen how much work they've done with that team, or with Immortals in this match. But I mean, Nico there in the site, low HP and just executes Lucas. Just very, very quick kill. And that's even the one thing with that tactic. Even if you have that player in pit, I mean, he FNX lived long enough to make it worthwhile. But even if he dies there, you have two players in lane next to it, and that's when they get crunched as well. So these kind of defenses that Immortals have had in the A bomb site are very much susceptible. There's a lot of points of collapse that as soon as one player falls, just it gets so weakened.
No, I think we're seeing that. And this was the round where... God, what? That barrel is incredibly strong. But still, we are back into this. Immortals, their money, we're going to be well aware that their money's going to be low. Nice connection early on there, but a kill would have been far greater for Henny. He's going to have to just accept it, back away, because look at the rest of their team. I guess for him, staying alive, staying integral to this round is imperative.
Definitely would have loved the kill there, considering that's one of the few weapons they have. That and the M4 on Lucas. Interestingly enough, both at the B bomb site. So just saying, you know, if you come B, we have a good chance of winning this. But if not, the A defense is going to be severely weakened. FaZe at the moment, though, fortunately, this isn't the round. They seem like they commit to one of the sides of this map pretty early on. They know the AWP was here earlier, so it is a little bit interesting seeing them go right at it. How are they going to make Henny feel uncomfortable? How are they going to apply pressure? They've got nades, they've got Molotov flashbangs as well. We've seen Henny be effective with the AWP in this bomb site in the past, so this is going to be a challenge.
Henny, it's a matter of timing now. We're going to see the smokes. What do they have for his spot? It's a flash and it's enough. That's more than you need to do. And Rain just barreling forward. Lucas now surrounded on all fronts. He can only do so much, and one kill is all you're going to get here. And this is a very well-constructed hit so far from FaZe. Sadly for Immortals, simply don't have enough to be able to stop it.
Yeah, I mean, that flashbang comes out so late. I actually thought that, and maybe Henny did too. Ooh, that's nice from Steel. Brought it into a 3-on-3. Alu's there for the punish, though. And they've got to go for this. They've got to try and make it work. And so far, it's okay. They have no kits, two CZs, though, and too much of an advantage for Nico in this fight. And Bolts with 15 HP. I think the danger has subsided. He's going to smoke it off. He's got to pray for a 10-second defuse with 4 HP.
No.
So far,
no.
He's doing it. This can't happen.
No.
4-3.
Are
Is he
going to
do this? Oh, thank God. That was so scary.
That's ridiculous. Okay, let's take a breath. Let's just bring it back. It's okay. FaZe, let's take stock of this. They are on 15 rounds, and Keo has bought a sort of shotgun. I love that on the T side. Just fly out apps, why not? Just embrace the spirit of JW, even though he's no longer in the tournament.
It's only effective if it's the Kraken skin.
That's very true. It's
nah,
not.
It's not.
Can someone please help out Keo here and, you know, hook him up? But at the moment, we'll see what he can do with it. It's hilarious to see him with this, but I guess, in a way, he couldn't afford much more.
I mean, the thought process of using this shotgun as well, going into halls as a terrorist, I mean, this is where sometimes you'll see a player from the CT side, especially on these kind of force buys.
Yep.
That's where maybe they get aggressive with a shotgun or a CZ, just trying to find that one kill where they can salvage a rifle. So holding up the close angles with the sawed-off, designed exactly to punish that kind of a push.
Yeah, I'm not against it. Absolutely not. Especially when the rest of FaZe are perfectly fine. They have everything they want as well, so they can just build into this how they please to, how they intend to. But the thing is that we finally see a little bit... No, it's not the boost anymore. You can jump up there yourself in the first boxes. So Henny's up there. A little bit of a flash comes over, but FaZe just walking in. Look at Rain. Straight out. He's not messing around. And oh, the timing is a disaster for Immortals. Rain is straight there. Three players now encroaching. The bomb's not even with them, but they've had just marvelous work already towards this site. And this looks like this might be all she wrote for map one.
Yeah, Kerrigan coming back with the bomb. He's just going to drop it in, make sure he can watch the flank. Kerrigan had cut off one rotation. It's a 2-on-4. Again, no kits, though. Immortals, they've just been starved of any utility. And here comes the sawed-off. Flashbang over. Keo turns, and it's going to be put to use, but he doesn't get the kill. But Bolts, I mean, you got to run through fire, you got to run through flashbangs, eating everything, and you've just got to go for it. But Alu's going to end it. FaZe, they hold strong despite maybe a mistake in the first half, but the second half is just as dominant. And they're going to take this first map 16-9. So Immortals going into the next map with their backs against the wall.
Yeah, a very compelling start there coming out from the FaZe boys. They can take this one away, just learn a couple of pieces, maybe kind of rope themselves back in. Don't let them get too ahead of themselves. There's still Mirage coming up next. And there's a lot to be said about this one, I can imagine. And I see the analysis getting themselves over there right now to break this one down for you guys. So just do stay tuned for that. They've got a lot to say about this. And you know, Nico and Yanko, there's a lot going on between those two. And I'm sure they have a lot to say about this performance.
FaZe cause an upset versus the team that has been prone to causing them themselves. Yes, indeed, Immortals have done exactly what we expected. They threw the wild card in, they got themselves the Inferno, and FaZe have done the damage. Joining me to go ahead and break down exactly how Inferno did go to FaZe, I have Yanko Paunovic and Chad Burchill. We knew it was going to be a risky maneuver in that map, Vito, picking Inferno. Hasn't paid off for Immortals, but looking back in hindsight, would you still suggest this was the right call?
Well, I think that first half was a fair scoreline of 9-6, right? Both teams didn't capitalize on the positions they had, especially Immortals when they won Pistol, and then the FaZe were on top. They lost that silly round where they pushed mid and they were able to, they got basically eco'd, and that gave Immortals another chance to get on top of the economy. They couldn't convert that again. So 9-6 in the end was a pretty fair half, I think. On the T side for FaZe, I thought they were extremely well-versed. They had a lot of smoke grenades. They looked well-prepared, a lot of executes. They looked calm. FaZe well-rounded on Inferno.
FaZe have done their homework with, how long has it been with Nico now?
3 days, and then what they had at the tournament. That's the thing with Kerrigan, you can always count on him. Even with a limited amount of time, they are going to have a couple of set strats in place, you know, as Chad mentioned, good usage of utility. Besides that, they have great individuals that they can also rely on to create openings, right? We saw Kiyoshima almost acing on an eco round and winning it for his team. So definitely a lot of diversity in that team.
Yeah. And I think, just to expand a bit of praise for Kyo, that round, he did a lot of economical damage, Chad, which can't be overlooked. I mean, you didn't win the round, sure, but that was incredibly damaging in the grand scheme of things.
It definitely felt like he was going to there at the end. When
right.
I think it was FNX was jumping in the pit. I was like, dude, you're on 35 HP. He just has to land one bullet on you and you're dead. You're not giving Lucas any time. I was really freaking out.
Yeah.
They converted it in the end, but yeah, lots of props to Kyo. He was an anchor in that pit.
Chucking the AWP out as well.
Yeah, you know, you gotta use all the guns from time to time.
Not too shabby.
When talking about AWPers, it's quite difficult for Hen 1 to get the AWP going on the T side, right? It's a map where you can get isolated by smokes. What?
Hen 1.
Oh.
Seriously?
Oh, Enrique, sorry. Well, if we want to be correct about
it. You can do it properly, yeah.
But I think, you know, he had a lot of work with those pistols. So we obviously didn't see a lot of flashy AWP play from him, but that's because they can smoke, Molotov, basically keep him out of the game. He was able to use his pistols and get his team in the match, but, you know, it just wasn't there for them.
He truly does seem to have come alive when on the stage. I mean, we saw numerous occasions where he seemed to have FaZe playing scared. Some people in FaZe weren't scared, though. 27 for Nico. You said he was going to put a stop sign on B, Yanko. He did just that.
And they did put the stop sign, Alex, actually. When you look at it, they did something that we saw from North early on Inferno. So I was talking about banana control, how it's super important, and was curious to see how teams approach it. So what FaZe does here is they will smoke up off the banana late. They will use their incendiaries to cut off the area in front of the smokes, and also they'll use their HE grenades to clear out this little corner here that was the old tree was at. So you can play it out to see how it looks. That's a way to approach it a bit later on in the round, because it's difficult for the CTs to fight for banana control early now. They can't throw the deep smokes and everything. So you can see that the Molotovs will cover pretty much the whole of banana, and you can see how Nico is on his rifle after this, waiting for someone to perhaps push through the Molotov towards them. The players either take a lot of damage, you throw the grenade so they can possibly even die, but you regain that banana control and you gain some information. You can see that they were in a 5v3 round. FaZe was a bit reckless at this point. They let it come to a basically 2v3, but in the end, they were still saved by Kiyoshima and managed to win the round. It was a reset round, but, you know, Immortals had to eco after this, so FaZe got some early momentum going.
Yeah, and we also saw two instances where Immortals won with a quasi-slash-eco, Chad. Was that just FaZe? Is this just evidence that FaZe still have some kind of
restraint to learn?
I think it's a little bit from column A and a little bit from column B. And column B being, you know, how good they were with pistols in those instances. You're not expecting to get your head taken off by a P250 one bullet all the time, right? You have the advantage of utility, armor, weaponry. It isn't something which is always going to go against you. And just in those occasions it did, it was just unfortunate for FaZe that in that time it almost reset their economy. However, like they were able to capitalize and then reset again once more onto Immortals. I think we saw that round with the player in Halls with the shotgun. So they were just across the board better individually, and they played the game better as a team as well, and that's why I think the victory was quite easy.
Yeah, the all-star roster of FaZe indeed did pick up the win on Inferno. Whether they can replicate that success on Mirage, it is their map pick. We'll be discussing it all after the break. Yanko and Chad will be back with me to discuss Mirage. Will FaZe do what they were seen to do before getting to that grand final stage? Will they go ahead and knock Immortals down in the semis? We'll find out as we talk it through after the break.
This is the